All right, good. So, hello everyone. I hope you're all doing fine. I hope you have your coffee at hand. So today, I'm very happy to introduce to you Francisca Kemper. She was my advisor, my postdoc advisor in Taiwan, and has been part of the SAGE team, which is a collaboration I've been part of as well since its inception. She's also been the PI of the SAGE SPEC program, which was a spectroscopic follow-up on about, what is it, about 1,000 targets, is that right? Yeah, in the Large Magellanic Cloud with the Switzer Space Telescope. Francisca received her PhD from the University of Amsterdam, where she worked with Rens Vaters, Sander Thielens, and Alex de Korter on dust production around AGB stars. After this, she was a Spitzer Fellow at UCLA, and then she held a faculty position at the University of Virginia, and then after that at Manchester. She currently holds a joint position as an Associate Research Fellow at Academia Sinica in Taiwan, and also as ALMA Program Scientist at ESO in Munich. Francisca has a really wide variety of research interests, including evolved stars, pre-main sequence stars, the Milky Way, nearby galaxies, the AGN, the life cycle of dust and gas in galaxies, as well as instrumentation in the infrared. Today, she's going to talk about one of these topics, which is the origin of dust in galaxies. Take it away, Francisca. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Let me go ahead and share my screen. Share. We just tried this, so it should work. I hope. Yes, here we go. Okay, so, I need to make all your windows go away. Right, so otherwise I still see the audience on top of my slides. So I'm going to talk about the origin of dust in galaxies. And this topic is motivated by some work that started appearing sort of in the early 2000s, where people were reporting very high dust masses at high redshifts using submillimeter observations in particular. And here on the right hand side, you see some of these observations. And at the redshift of 6 or larger, people reported 10 to the 8 to 10 to the 9 solar masses of dust in some of these galaxies. And this amount of dust cannot be explained with stellar dust sources, as was already demonstrated early on by Morgan and Edmonds. In the lower right, lower left plot, where the dust production by AGB stars and supernovae is compared with the actual level of dust that's seen 1 billion year after the after Big Bang. So we wanted to look into this, or a lot of my research has focused on looking into this question. And one of the things that there's actually three science questions that I want to focus on in the context of this talk. And the first one is, to what extent are AGB stars actually responsible for the interstellar dust reservoir in galaxies? And I'll demonstrate this based on studies of nearby galaxies, in particular the Magellanic Clouds that we already heard about from Sundar. And how, on the other side of the equation, how well do we actually know the masses of the interstellar dust reservoir in galaxies? So that's, you know, are we comparing like with like, in fact? And then finally, an important key in the puzzle is the assumption that interstellar dust is the same for all galaxies. This is what people do. They look at high-rich galaxies and then model them, assuming that the dust is the same as what we see locally. But is this really the case? So we're looking into this question as well. Then, first looking at the first question, galactic dust production rate by AGB stars, a lot of this work has been done using the SAGE LMC and SMC survey. So first the LMC survey. So this is actually a 7x7 degree map that we did of the Large Magellanic Cloud using Spitzer at first in all 7 bands available in Spitzer, and later also with Herschel in the longer wavelength bands. We identified 8.5 million infrared point sources. Those are the sources that actually have an IRAC 3.6 detection. As you go to progressively longer wavelengths, you will see fewer and fewer sources. But we have a catalog with 8.5 million point sources. Similarly, the SMC survey, which came out a few years later, also used had a very similar setup with Spitzer. It has a somewhat different geometry. It's not a nice square, but it, you know, we wanted to cover part of the bridge as well. But we ended up with a catalog containing about 2 million infrared point sources. And using this catalog of IRAC and MIPS point sources that we had, combined with two mass and even optical data. So actually part of the project was to match all these point sources against two mass and optical counterparts. We were able to make SEDs and fit them with dust models. And actually Sundar has been one of the people that was very instrumental in this, having calculated a grid for carbon-rich HB stars, which you see in the lower left plot on the right hand side, where you see all these red dots. And on the left hand side, you have the oxygen rich grid. So it's basically a dust radiative transfer model with either containing carbon rich or oxygen rich dust that for a variety of physical parameters, we calculated the emerging SED. And compared these SEDs with the observations to find the best fit. So basically the observations were compared against a library of model fits. And in doing so, and at the top two panels, you see some typical fits for the oxygen rich on the left and on the carbon rich on the right. You're actually able to determine the total dust production rate by summing up all these individual fits, because we know we can actually successfully classify the AGP stars in this spectrum based, in this set sample based on their colors. And the table summarizes the results for the LMC. So the total dust production rate is 20 times 10 to the minus 6 solar masses per year. And then it's divided up into different categories, carbon-rich AGP, oxygen-rich AGP, and red supergiants. Those together sum up to 100%. And then extreme AGBs is a subcategory of carbon-rich and oxygen-rich AGB stars. And this is actually a small number of sources, but they produce the majority of the dust production. For the SMC, we find in a very similar analysis, which Sundar carried out while he was at ASIAA, we find numbers that are a factor of 15 lower. This exercise can also be repeated for other galaxies in the local group. For instance, M33 is one of the two spiral galaxies in the local group. So far, this work has been done on the central part of the of M33 and using IRAC data only. So there are some shortcomings there, but in the central part, a dust production rate of 5 times 10 to the minus 5 solar masses per year has been derived. M32, a satellite galaxy of Andromeda, has some useful Spitzer observations as well, although there were some shortcomings there in the data itself. And my student Libby Jones did an excellent job in trying to determine this dust production rate for M32. And because this galaxy, the source density is so high in the center, you cannot identify all the sources there. And in the outer parts of the galaxy, there is contamination from M31. So there's only part of the sort of concentric rings around the center that you can actually use for the analysis, which is shown in the two panels on the right, where between about 1 and 2 arc minutes away from the center, you get a good fit to a typical stellar density profile, and the rest you will just have to extrapolate. And using this information, she derived a dust production rate of 1.5 times 10 to the minus 4 solar masses per year, with the 5 most extreme sources, again only in these concentric rings, of course, producing 30% of the dust. And if you reduce your analysis only to those sources that are actually variable in multi-epoch IRAC data, which are therefore confirmed AGB stars, so there's an additional requirement in, on top of just the colors, we get 5 to 10% of the value. So yes, there are some difficulties there, but we are quite confident that objects with similar colors that are not variable are still AGB stars because they are such bright and uniquely shaped SEDs. Now, another interesting object and local group is, of course, our own Milky Way. But we have a problem because we're in it. It's an entirely different analysis. You don't have the external viewpoint to nicely count all the AGB stars, even if they stand out so well in the infrared. So you'll have to do your work while you're sitting in the middle of it. And we have been working on a project for quite a long time now, because it's so complicated, to do a volume limited sample, so out to about 2 kiloparsecs, using all sky infrared surveys to try to identify the AGB stars, the dust producing stars in this over the entire sky. And we're using all sky infrared surveys ranging from IRAS from the 80s all the way to things that have been done in the 2000s, such as WISE, Dumas, and Akari. And because we are sitting in the middle of it and there is such a large variety in the type of sources, we're dealing with a high dynamic range in the observations, and it's becoming very difficult to match the catalogs against each other. And the nearest targets turn out to be extended and sometimes saturated in some of these surveys. And the distances and the, therefore the luminosities of AGB stars in the solar neighborhood are not well known, despite the results from Gaia, for instance. And their extended nature and their variability are part of the reason here. But on the other hand, we can take a statistical approach, and our work on the LMC is very helpful here. So on the lower right, you see a plot showing the number density as a function of luminosity for carbon-rich and oxygen-rich, and the total number of AGB stars in the LMC. So you can actually give an expectation for what is the probability that a carbon-rich or oxygen-rich star has a certain luminosity. And you can use this to determine a luminosity-derived distance in case you don't have any other information on distance. And then assuming that these things kind of average out, you can derive a dust production rate in the solar neighborhood. And an initial number that we have is 4 × 10⁻⁵ solar masses a year. And we are extrapolating this to the disk of the Milky Way, the stellar disk of the Milky Way, for comparison with M31 and M33. And this work is in preparation and should be submitted soon. Now, you can actually put all these values that I've just been talking about on a scale, and I'm sure Sundar has already shown this to you at some point, because this is work that he and I have been talking about a lot. You can plot the dust production rate against the total stellar mass for a number of local galaxies. And so the galaxies that I've talked about are in the top right of this diagram. And there's another sample of galaxies, very low mass galaxies, dwarf galaxies, that are measured by Martha Boyer, and they're the pink dots on the left. And the whole set of galaxies in the local group, they sort of follow the broad trend that the dust production roughly scales with the total stellar mass in the galaxy. So that's a reassuring number, so that we know that, you know, all these galaxies produce dust at a more or less similar rate compared to their size. So far, all these dust production rates that I've been talking about have been determined in the mid-infrared. But you will see in a minute when I start talking about the dust masses in the interstellar medium, that on that side of the equation, dust masses are actually typically measured in the far infrared and the submillimeter. So in order to make things more comparable, we actually also want to determine dust masses in the submillimeter in AGB stars. And it turns out that that's not so easy, because it can only really be done for nearby AGB stars. And we put together a large program, the Nearby Evolved Star Survey, on the JCMT and also on APEX, where we target the 39 nearest dusty AGB stars in a level of detail that we actually make a map, plus a wedding cake survey of stars within 2 kiloparsecs that are selected according to completeness criteria as a function of mass loss rate. And that's what the figure shows. So for lower mass loss rates, we have completeness that doesn't take us out as far as the higher mass loss rates do. So the higher mass loss rates are the red dots, and we have completeness out to the 2 kiloparsec point. And we do both submillimeter continuum to determine the dust masses and also the dust mass loss history, as well as CO line transitions. And we have observations on the JCMT, two sets, NES1, which is completed, and NES2 in terms of observations completed, and NES2, which is ongoing currently. And then we have additional data from APEX Nomiyama and ongoing now ACA observations on ALMA. And the science goals of this project are actually diverse. It's not just the dust mass determinations, although that does play a role in it. We actually want to determine also the total gas return to the ISM using the CO observations. If you look at both the gas and the dust, we can do gas to dust ratios. We can look at the mass loss history, especially in those cases where we have, where we do maps. We want to constrain the submillimeter dust properties. We have a number of sources for which we have 13 CO observations, so we can look at the ratio between 13 CO and 12 CO. And like I said before, we want to compare this to the galactic dust production rate. And finally, we will also be able to detect deviations from spherical symmetry. And here are some initial plots from papers out of the survey that are in prep. So the top one is on the CO, the CO overview paper, where we actually look at a dust production, the empirical mass loss rate derived from the CO observations and the horizontal axis versus the dust production rate that has been fitted. And compare that to lines of constant gas to dust ratio, and you see that the ratio is all over the place. If you look at the maps of CO that we have for some of the brighter objects, you see that there is actually interesting variation in the line profile as you move along in the map. Here is some example on that on the right hand side. And at the bottom are maps of continuum emission, and you also see that the sources are clearly, or at least some of the sources, are clearly extended. So there too we see we can hopefully trace the mass loss history where the further out emission is coming from sort of older dust. The first paper coming out of the survey is a result on UANT, which has a detached shell. You can see on the left hand side in this diagram that that detached shell has been clearly detected in CO1 to 0. These are ALMA data. We've been able to see the same detached shell in continuum emission observed at the JCMT. So that's what the central panel shows. And on the right hand side, you see the radial profile of the continuum emission, where you can see this, extended shell as well. Now moving on to the interstellar dust mass. So the interstellar dust mass is typically determined by fitting a modified black body to far infrared and submillimeter emission, where the opacity of the coming of the dust is described as a power law with the wavelength, and the index is minus beta. And typically, people use either single or very few temperature components to do this fit. And but they use a single beta. And as you can see in the top right, that's an observation of Andromeda. You see that if you start a fitting point by point over an entire galaxy, you actually see that there is a large variation in beta across the galaxy. So if this were an unresolved galaxy, to fit this with a single beta might be a bit not very physical, so to say. And actually matters which beta you use, as is demonstrated in the plot below. If you have different betas and you do your observation at the reference frequency, so the two horizontal lines are the two SCUBA 2 JSMT wavelengths, you see that the emission varies a lot. And this, these plots are all for the same amount of dust with a reference opacity. You see that the emission at 415, 850 actually changes a lot. So if you use a different beta and you work backwards, you would get a different dust mass. And the reference opacity also matters. And this is on the right-hand side where kappa 500 is plotted for different studies. So Chris Clark has made a nice overview of this a couple of years ago and just tabulating all the values that he found in the literature. And he's finding a range of values for kappa 500, basically spanning three orders of magnitude. And the values that people typically use are the ones are the colored dots, and they are on the lower end of this range. So that is interesting. Then you quite easily end up with dust masses that are too high. So together with my postdoc, Lapa Ponciulo, we've been looking at what are sort of the systematic biases that you might run into when you are determining the interstellar dust masses. And one of them is that we started looking at dust opacities coming from the laboratory. So here is a presentation showing some experiments compared with what people typically use in the pits, which is the gray line in the lower left plot. And if you, one thing is immediately clear. Well, first of all the laboratory opacities are well above the line that is used in the pits normally. And the only, or the, the one where the difference is the smallest is the plot where the line is actually drawn. And another thing that you see is actually that the dust opacities are not constant with temperature. So for higher temperatures, the opacity is actually going up. And so it's not, the optical constants are not constant, basically. And so Lapo constructed a mixture of carbonaceous and silicate dust using these laboratory experiments and made it either compact or fluffy. The compact dust grains are the ones that are the red and blue lines that are solid, and the fluffy ones are the ones that are dotted. And the difference between red and blue lines is the temperature. So remember how the dust opacities vary with temperature. And all these lines are well above the values that people use in the literature to fit. So all these gray lines are different opacities that people have used to fit and determine dust masses. So what we did was we actually constructed a set of synthetic galaxies, synthetic spectral energy distributions from galaxies. And these galaxies were nothing more than a dust reservoir of a certain, a single temperature, which Lapo calls the T real. And as a function of temperature, you then get different SEDs, and these SEDs can be fitted using the observational methods that people use. And in putting these SEDs at different redshifts, you can repeat this this procedure. And what we're finding is that across the board, you have a difference between the fitted mass and the real mass that you put in the first place of, well, up to two orders of magnitude. Sorry, not two orders of magnitude, an order of magnitude, maybe a factor of 20 here. In case of, if you used a single temperature for to fit galaxies that were constructed using two temperatures, we find a similar result. Here the factor, so on the right-hand side, you see the SEDs that were constructed with two temperatures and the fit using a single temperature in the red line. And on the left-hand side, you again see the results. And now the factor is only a factor of about 5. And this is because we're using the fluffy grains in this plot. So it does matter whether you use the fluffy grains or the compact grains, but still you're a factor of 5 to factor 20 away from the mass measurements that people report. Now, bearing this in mind, we can actually turn to what people have published in the past. So again, this is the more traditional method. So these dust masses are going to be overestimated. But what we find is that if you look at the LMC, for instance, you look at the Herschel observations of the LMC, you can do a point-by-point analysis of the dust mass by fitting in the method that I just described and determine the ISM dust mass by fitting up the summation, by summing up the fit results. So you get a dust mass of 7 times 10 to the minus 5 solar masses if you do this. And if you compare this to the dust production rate, which we talked about earlier, which is about 2 to 4 times 10 to the minus 5 solar masses a year, and the star formation rate, which can also be derived from the SAGE point source catalog, which I won't talk about here, but the result is a bit higher than the dust production rate. But in terms of dust, the consumption by star formation is about 8 times 10 to the minus 4 solar masses a year. You get a replenishment time scale in the ISM if you replenish it all by dust production from evolved stars of a few times 10 to the 10 years. So basically the history, the age of the LMC itself, or the lifetime of the universe, or even longer, while the consumption, the astration time scale, is only 10 to the 8 years. So if you're not taking into account dust destruction and formation, which we're not doing in this case, the dust in the interstellar medium will be consumed quickly. And also, it's difficult to produce it by AGB stars in the first place. And in fact, this has also been shown in a more theoretical way by Rafael Schneider in 2014, a study that I was also a part of, where she has calculated theoretical yields of AGB stars over the entire star formation history of the LMC, but again, did not account for interstellar dust destruction. And the result that she gets for the entire history of the LMC is just about compatible with the measurement from the heritage result that I just showed before. So that's the little data point at the top left on the top right on the right hand side of the plots here. And but that means that we can just about do it with no dust destruction in the interstellar medium at all, which is not realistic. Now, looking at the mineralogy of interstellar dust, we can also draw some conclusions from that, the interstellar and circumstellar dust. So this is where SAGE-PEC comes into play, what's the survey that Suma mentioned that I was heading up. So I was part of SAGE, and then as my contribution led this survey, where we actually targeted 200 of these 8.5 million infrared point sources in the LMC, but we try to be representative over the color magnitude diagram as is shown in the top two plots. And we combine this with an additional 800 archival observations, also spectroscopy, that fell in the LMC, the SAGE footprint as well. And one of the goals was to do a quality control of the color classification that we did. So this diagram here, which actually shows the two mass color magnitude diagram, indicates where various types of AGB stars and red supergiants can be found to put the criteria that we used. And then we compared it with the spectroscopy to see if that actually was consistent with the color classification. And for instance, what you see that on the whole, this is gone quite well. So the color coding matches. So the larger symbols are the ones that have spectroscopy and they match the color coding of the dots, which only have photometry. So except for the oxygen-rich AGB stars, which kind of spill out of their wedge, we're doing quite a good job in identifying the subcategories. And on the whole, we're doing quite a good job in identifying what is an AGB star, what is a mass-losing star, and what is not. As you can see on the right-hand side, there's only a few interlopers, because the right-hand side shows all non-AGB stars. It's only a few interlopers that are falling in the range that is populated by AGB stars. And then we also use the spectroscopy to determine the dust composition, especially the dust composition that went into the Grams model grid that that Sundar and that Sargent made to actually produce the to actually estimate the dust production rates. And what we find for the carbon stars is that the representative fit shows that about 12% of the mass produced by AGB stars is in the form of silicon carbide, the rest is amorphous carbon. So in the model grid, we simplified that to 10%. And similarly, for the oxygen-rich dust, it was shown that actually, good on the whole, a good fit was obtained by just using amorphous silicon. So that is what the model grid is based on. And we did a comparison. So on the left-hand side, so now we add up all this dust production again that we have from this table that I showed quite a few slides ago. But we actually now multiply it, or we take into account the composition of this dust. And if you do so, you find that about 3/4 of the dust that is being produced by AGB stars is in the form of amorphous carbon. And of the remainder, it's half and half amorphous silicates and silicon carbides, with a very tiny wedge being due to other components. Whereas if you look in the interstellar medium, and this is actually for the Milky Way on the right hand side, but we believe that the LMC is quite similar, the amorphous silicates make up the lion's share, and then so the situation is more or less reversed, with amorphous carbon a much smaller component. So we're showing here that AGB and ISM dust are not the same thing. So this conclusion that the AGB dust is responsible for all the ISM dust is clearly clearly not valid. So how about the dust composition in different galaxies? So this is a little bit of a diversion. So one of the assumptions that goes into the dust dust mass determinations in external galaxies is that dust is the same everywhere you look, and people use dust models that are nicely tabulated. Train and Lee is an example. People use that to estimate their dust masses because it's also well determined. But this is well determined for the Milky Way, for our local dust composition. And there are very different environments in the universe with very different conditions. So here's an example. So we have an active galaxy. And if you zoom in on the center here, you see actually the stellar part of this this galaxy, an elliptical galaxy. And in the very center, and the orientation of this figure is wrong, of course, you have an AGN that drives these radio lobes that you're seeing. And if you look in more detail what's going on in the very center of this galaxy, the physical model for an active galactic nuclei, then you have a supermassive black hole at the center surrounded by an accretion disk. Jets are being launched at the point where the material falls into the black hole. And further out, you have a dusty torus, which has been invoked to sort of explain the different observations that we have. And this dusty torus then obscures the central engine from view or not. So, and then you have either a type 2 or a type 1 AGN. Sort of adjacent to the jets, there are slower winds where you have narrow line and broad line regions with clouds in them. So, and depending on the viewing angle, so if you have this torus around it, and depending on the viewing angle, and if you assume that this torus contains mostly silicate dust, you would see then the silicate feature at 10 micron, either in absorption or emission, depending on the viewing angle. So here you see the different viewing angles and the resulting SED predicted by model calculations or radiative transfer calculations already in the 90s. However, until Spitzer, in fact, the absorption features have been readily seen due to silicate in AGN towards AGN, but silicate emission features have not been detected. And then in 2005, very soon after Spitzer actually became operational, there were three independent groups that reported silicate emission features towards quasars. And this plot that we're seeing here is from Sieben Morgan, I believe, but the other two, Howardall and Sturmedal, have very similar results. And the red line is actually the galactic center silicate absorption feature, shown here as an emission feature. So you can see that the feature is somewhat reddened, and this is not, so this has already been corrected for redshift, obviously, so this is really an intrinsic reddening of the feature. And this is observed across the board, so the others report this too. And very quickly, people went on to try to explain this, and why does this dust actually look different? One of the ideas was being floated was that porosity might play a role, and this was already identified as something that could alter the appearance of silicates by Iyati et al. In 2001, so prior to this observational result. But Eigenlee repeated this work, and what you see is that the on the right hand side is perhaps more clear to see. So the blue line at the top is a solid silicate, but as you start adding vacuum into the grains, so making the grains more porous, the feature not only becomes weaker, but it also shifts to longer wavelengths. So that might explain what we're seeing observationally, but it also means that we have a hard time to explain it because the feature starts to become really, really faint. Nevertheless, Eigen was able to explain some observations, initially only the 10 micron feature in his 2008 paper. So we have some different fits of the 10 micron feature that go quite well for two galaxies, in fact. So the two galaxies that we just saw, I believe, so 3C273 and NGC3998. But if you take that fit and look at what it does at longer wavelengths, it either fits one or the other galaxy reasonably well, but not both. So that wasn't going very well. But then a few years later, in another study that Eigenlee was also involved in, they did a better job in fitting the infrared spectrum of an AGN with porous dust, M81 in this case. Other authors have suggested that perhaps it's due to optical depth effects. If you have a large amount of silicates, the 10 micron emission feature starts to appear in self-absorption. And when that happens, the appearance of the 10 micron feature also changes and it seems to shift to longer wavelengths. So in this paper by Nikota et al. In 2009, this effect seems to fit a particular spectrum in a larger sample really quite well, but it seems to be a bit of a chance match because other spectra look really quite a bit different. And this only works if the 10 and 20 micron feature are quite similar in strength. So it may play some role, but it doesn't explain the whole story. And then sort of around the same time, Sarah Gallagher and I wrote a proposal for Spitzer to look at these clouds embedded in the broad and narrow regions in the, where the winds are coming off the disk. And our idea was that, and this had already been predicted by Martin Elvis, that dust may form in these clouds. And in the lower right-hand side, what you're seeing is the plot showing the stability limits for different solid state components as a function of temperature and density. And let me see how I can say this best. The dashed and the dotted line are the limits, the boundaries of the conditions that we find in AGB envelopes. So so static and dynamic envelopes. So anything sort of between that range should give the right conditions for dust formation. So these two solid lines coming down from the top to the bottom show the conditions that are encountered by clouds in the broad emission line winds as they move out. And as they go from higher temperatures to lower temperatures, and as they move out, they pass all these stability limits, and they may indeed form dust, oxygen-rich dust in this case. The constraint, of course, is that this shouldn't go too fast. So you shouldn't pass through this diagram too fast that you end up with very low density and very low temperatures very quickly, because then you don't form dust. But this has been checked by Elvis et al. And the time scale seems to be such that dust formation indeed occurs. And then, if you allow this idea that dust formation occurs in these winds that are lifting up the disk and the plot at the top, at the right, shows what the direction of these winds is, so that those are the blue arrows and the red arrows are the different winds. You can then start to imagine that, well, if a lot of dusty clouds are forming in these winds, couldn't that be actually what we call the torus? I mean, couldn't it be that, you know, if these winds really are very dusty, could that not be the torus? Because people have found it very difficult to explain a static torus that doesn't really collapse onto itself, but a wind like this in which dust clouds form might be a very satisfactory explanation. And so we asked for Spitzer observations, spectroscopy. It was awarded, and we had only 5 spectra because their observations were actually very difficult. And one of them was really a very nice emission spectrum. So because of the viewing angle, we did actually have an emission spectrum of the silicates, and we produced this really nice fit where we see a range of dust components, not just silicates. We also see this broadening. We add different dust components to explain it, corundum in this case, which is an aluminum oxide. We also see magnesium oxide, which is necessary to explain the broadening of the 20 micron feature. And we add phosphorite to the mix to explain some features in the spectrum, making this partially crystalline. And then I had this idea in my head for a long time, you know, we should do this on a larger sample. And eventually when Sundar was with me in ASIAA in Taiwan, I gave him this problem and we worked out, we selected quite a large sample of objects that we could do this for, that actually had suitable spectra, and fitted them all according to the same recipe. So here are some example fits. So you see there is a huge variety of spectral appearance. Here is just two. I mean, if you go through this catalog that we have of spectra, they are, you know, every one is different from the next. So it's really quite fun to look at. And the fit results, we summarized it in this diagram, are in fact all over the place in terms of composition. So the different species are listed at the bottom, and then the mass fraction taken up by the species are shown on the left-hand side. And these box plots indicate the range of compositions that we find. We ultimately had a sample of 53 objects that we look at. And you see that amorphous silicates, crystalline silicates, we find in all oxides as well. We look at the corundum, the aluminum oxide, and the magnesium oxides, and we see a large variety. So my conclusions, and timing is good. So the conclusions are that I hope I have convinced you that the interstellar dust mass that we see in galaxies is larger than the sum of the dust produced by HV stars. I mean, I've shown it for the LMC, but this is sort of the general trend that we're seeing. Additionally, we're also seeing that the composition of the dust, the ISM dust, is not HV star, HV dust. So the dust composition is actually different. And also, if you look in terms of the time integrated dust production rate, you just about match the interstellar dust mass, but then dust destruction and nitration is not taken into account. So if you take that into account, it no longer fits. Then looking at the one side of the equation, the submillimeter dust masses, which are compared to infrared dust masses produced by HB stars, then in that picture, the submillimeter dust masses seem to be overestimated. And this is because the typical opacities that people use differ from lab measurements by a factor of about 10. And then the actual derived masses also, I didn't really show this in much detail, but actually strongly depend on the temperature that you fit. We only used a single temperature population of dust in our synthetic galaxies, or a two temperature. But if you start looking into a range of temperatures and you try to characterize this by a single temperature, what temperature you actually end up fitting this with is going to have a huge effect on the derived dust mass. And then the variation in the AGN dust mineralogy as a function of properties apparently suggests that universal dust properties are in fact entirely unrealistic. And looking forward, so I want to keep focusing on this interstellar dust budget crisis, as it was named, focus on the one hand, the re-evaluation of interstellar dust masses and opacities. So there's still a lot that could be done. We should, for instance, compare dust masses at the same wavelength and not look at this infrared on the one hand and submillimeter on the other hand. So really look at the HB stars at submillimeter wavelengths as well. We should take into account the constraints that we have from abundances. Temperature effects, I already mentioned this. Also, scale effects could play a role. What people have seen is where they have these maps of dust emission at different wavelengths. For instance, the one of the LMC that I showed. If you do the dust mass fit on a pixel by pixel basis, and you add up the resulting dust mass, and you compare that to what you would get for the dust mass for the integrated SED, these numbers are not necessarily the same. So how does the scale come into play? And then also to evaluate the physical meaning of beta, that is actually one of the parameters. And then once we get a better handle on this, and if there's still a need for additional dust sources, we also want to look into that, looking into aspects of interstellar grain growth, the contribution by other stellar sources, such as supernova progenitors, luminous blue variables may be important here, and non-stellar sources of dust, such as quasar winds that I talked about briefly. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Siska. So now would be the time, if people have questions, to raise your hands. I can see Will is getting ready to raise his hand.
I don't want to disappoint.
Go for it, Will.
Nobody else wants to ask a question first? No? Okay. All right. Hi, my name's Will Hennies. This was a very interesting talk. I have a couple of questions about the opacities.
Yes.
So the opacity depends not just on the optical constants, but also on the size distribution. So I'm wondering when you say that the laboratory experiments give a larger opacity, Is that because of a different optical constant than what's assumed in the drain and Lee mixture, or is it due to a different assumed size distribution?
So it's the mass absorption coefficient, right? So yes, if you have optical constants, you have to translate it to mass absorption coefficients, right? So yes, you assume something for, perhaps some of the difference can also be explained by inadequate choices. If you start with optical constants for the grain shape or size distribution, the measurements, the laboratory measurements that we compared with, were actually mass absorption coefficient measurements. So they can be directly used to determine dust masses. But there are others that have actually put effort in to arrive optical constants. But the ones we used for now were actually mass absorption coefficients.
Okay, but is that on the bulk? Is that on the bulk solid, or is it?
No. They're powder, and so they try to make it representative. But in fact, there is a bit of coagulation and fluffiness to that
sample. Okay.
So yes. Okay. Which is why we ended up making two, because we used that sample at first, and if you assume that it's actually small solid, small, very small 0.1 micron solid grains, then you get an overestimate of about a factor of 20. But if you take into account that it's a bit fluffy, then the overestimate is going to be a bit smaller.
Oh, okay. Thanks.
Yeah. So and that is to some extent already taken into account. Yeah. So this is a first exploration, and obviously we need to look into this a bit more. It's not here on the slide, but we need to reevaluate the opacities themselves as well. Yes.
Okay. And a slightly related question. So you talked mainly about the fine for red opacity. Do these same results have any implications for the mid-infrared opacity and near-infrared? Is that predicted to be different from what's been assumed as well?
No, we have a much better handle on the mid-infrared opacity. So part of the reason that we're doing this is that if you look at your typical opacities that people use for these kind of fits, they take, for instance, drain and leak, and they don't really, they're basically extrapolated from the mid-infrared, right? So we wanted to compare extrapolations with real lab measurements. And somehow people haven't combined the real lab measurements at all wavelengths somehow. So we're trying to make a more realistic comparison. So the typical opacities that people use, or the optical constant, if you wish, are extrapolations from mid-infrared. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Well. Who's next? Anybody else? Questions? Yes, Jesus, go ahead.
Yeah, thanks. I never thought about this silicate versus carbon chemistry. This is very new in my head. So although massive stars can produce silicate molecules, how many do you need? How many LDPs do you need in order to explain this? Is it this very strong?
Yeah, so the thing is, when I first saw these results for the LMC, and when we realized that, you know, the HB stars are producing sort of 3/4 of the HB dust is carbon, right? And only a quarter is silicates. We were kind of scratching our heads. And the reason is that the metallicity is lower. So for these HB stars, it's easier to become carbon rich, right? But if you look at the ISM is actually not carbon rich, right? So in the big scheme of things, these HB stars do not change the chemistry of the ISM. So the massive stars are clearly still important. What matters now is the ejecta from the massive stars, is whether they enter the ISM in the gas phase, or that they enter as solid. So supernovae, dust production, or other types of massive stars, or VA stars, LDPs, or whatever. Is there dust production sufficient to actually change that balance to become oxygen rich, or do they just supply the elements, and then dust formation occurs in the interstellar medium? But there is no doubt in my mind, and actually we've looked into this with, you know, like the chemical evolution models, that the ISM is oxygen rich. The question is whether the dust grains are formed by these stars, or that they just supply the elements and they form later on in the ISM.
Because massive stars, I mean, you see silicates features in Wolfram, yeah, ABA, yeah, so, and LDV stars, but are they numerous enough?
It's enough, right? Is it enough? Yes. Well, in terms of elemental abundance, these stars clearly produce enough, right? And but is the actual is, does it enter the ISM as solids or not? That's the question. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks. It was a very nice talk.
Thanks, Jesus. Who's next? Any questions?
Shall I stop my share?
Sure. Okay, if we don't have any more questions, then let's thank our speaker again. Thank you, Francisca.